All right, so this is my 84 Rabbit GTI, and I was having high idle, amongst other things. This car was a basket case when I originally picked it up and suffered from severe neglect, so just getting it running was a major undertaking, reliably replacing the gas tank and such. Now I'm at the point where I get to kind of refine that experience, and with CIS systems, especially this system, which is considered CISE, meaning that there's an oxygen sensor that feeds the engine computer, which is located where that firewall grommet is. There's a Jetronic ECU in there, and it will take your oxygen sensor input, which is via this lead here, the beige insulator around it, and it will send whatever it decides to adjust your fuel to this guy right here, which is right at the tip of my finger. There is the electrical plug that goes to the frequency valve, and that will adjust small adjustments to trim effectively your fuel ratio so that it's accurate. With CIS, as this flapper door comes up, the volume of air that has made it past there is expected to show up at the O2 sensor essentially unmolested and not have any air leaks or either additions or subtractions of air volume to that, so that it can put the correct amount of fuel and have the ECU figure out the correct amount of fuel to put in there to give you efficient combustion, most power, and the least amount of pollution. So what happens on these old cars, with any of them, is as the oil leaks out of the compromised or aged or unreplaced valve cover gaskets, is it takes out everything slowly. It happens over years, but anything that's rubber, plastic, or a gasket, or made out of fibrous material like a clutch disc, it will slowly destroy that. I've had clutches fail on my old Mark 1s because of oil leaking out of the valve cover gasket. You can use a 2-liter ABA out of like a 94 to 99 Jetta Golf with the 2-liter ABA engine in it. You'll have to change the studs out if you do. You'll have to go with ones that are not shouldered, and I'll show you an example of that in a little bit here. So as that valve cover gasket leaks, it takes out our intake manifold gaskets, and they end up with dirt and just end up damaged and slowly leaking air. And that's just one possible culprit. So oil slowly takes out those. Another one that I've already dealt with, but had addressed earlier, but want to go over, are these O-rings that fit over the CIS fuel injectors. You know, having a good look at that, as well as the injector seats, which are these beige guys here, and they require a 11 millimeter Allen key. So that's another source. Even if those are loose, if you just replace them and it doesn't fix your problem, make sure you've tightened them enough and make sure you get the correct tool. So on from that, you can have a look at where other sources of unmetered air may have made it into the system. In this case, these are my exhaust manifold gaskets, and here's a new one for comparison. When I install these, I'm in the habit of doing this using Permatex Ultra Copper. It's an orangish color. It's good to 700 degrees intermittently, Fahrenheit, I'm not sure. 600 degrees Fahrenheit continuous, 700 degrees intermittent Fahrenheit. So I replace those to, again, reduce the chance of air leaks and such. And I think the thing that impressed me most about this is I use this product here, Evaporust, to basically get that manifold looking like it's been bead blasted. And then I've used a clear ceramic VHT high temperature paint to coat it. This is a G60 flywheel that I put in last night, and it was looked like Mars. Now it doesn't. So, pretty impressive. So far I've done this manifold and another one that I needed to extract some rusted parts from. It's over here. It's this cracked one that was originally on that car. See, there's a huge crack right down the middle. Anyways, these look like any exhaust manifold would. It was just rusty and gross. And both of them managed to end up coming out looking really good. The other ones that I have just sitting above the heater here are a couple of VR6 manifolds. I just put those in, and I'm just going to show you guys some pictures of what they kind of looked like. This is actually after pulling them out. To get this result, oops, wrong way. There we go. So that's just after taking it out and cleaning it up. That's the first coat of paint, and those are the VR6 manifolds that I mentioned before. And they look that good. So again, I replaced this one because of the crack. I got a couple of these because I get the feeling they're going to get harder to find. Those are the manifold downpipe gasket. These are the manifold downpipe clamps. I also ended up putting this in the evaporust, not this one, but a different one that's already mounted, because the end here had simply turned into rust. There's not much left in there. So I've got these caps for the existing one that I've installed, that again I used Evapo Rust on to get the all the rust off and stuff. So yeah, managed to get all this dealt with. New copper nuts, new gaskets. You can see a little bit of that orange silicone probably seeping out. Pretty clean. I used a, I'll go get the tap in a second, tell you what diameter it is for the O2 sensor hole, which is right down there. I've chosen to do this. I mean, I know a header is going to make more power, but I just want to have a good stock original car. It's just what I choosing to pursue right now. As I mentioned, injector seats, or maybe mentioned or haven't mentioned, those injector seats require a 11 millimeter Allen key, which is can be a bit of a challenge to find. Exhaust manifold gasket. I've chosen to put, and this might be kind of foolish, stainless steel acorn nuts on top of the copper nuts, primarily because when I do attack this again, I just don't want to have corrosion preventing those nuts from coming off, breaking studs, because I broke 4 on this, and it turned this basic car repair into like a 2-week ordeal as I went from helicoiling and tapping and trying to find all these different ways of extracting these broken studs that were stuck in here. And that's another thing that I wanted to go over. So one of the things that I wanted to get was a left-hand drill bit set. So I managed to pick up one of those. These are cobalt. And as you drill in, it cuts in the same direction that you would loosen the fastener, in this case the exhaust manifold stud. So I kind of highly recommend those because they will assist in loosening. There's our 11 millimeter Allen key for the injector seats, a random assortment of stainless that I use for Mark 1s and all the other vehicles I have, because I'm so tired of corrosion. Oxidization is one of the things that I like the least. So drilling out the studs, I would start with a good self-punching center punch, whatever that's called, where you load it up and it snaps a nice spot in there so that you can start your drill bit. If you have air tools, right angle drill is pretty pretty much a requirement. I was able to get away with an inexpensive short die grinder back there. And then Healy coils, or whatever this stuff's considered, fix a thread. The exhaust manifold studs are right there, M8 by 1.25. M8 by 1.25. I'll skip right ahead a week and a bit in advance and tell you exactly what it is that fixed my problem. And that was this step stud here. And these are included in most, probably 2 liter TDI, 1.8T, like Mark IV type vehicles. And this stud is perfect. It's 10 by 1.5 at this end, and then it's 8 by 1.25 at this end. So 8 millimeters in diameter, 1.25 millimeters between the tip or base of each thread. And you don't need expensive tools to figure the diameter out. It's pretty straightforward. But when it comes to figuring out your thread pitch, you can do it with that other tool that I showed, the vernier caliper. But ideally, something more like this is what you want, a thread gauge. And you're just looking to get these. I wonder if this will focus. Here we go. 1.5 and 1.25 will match up with our different threads, and you just seat them in there. That should get exactly what you're looking for. So anyways, I went far too in detail on that. The studs that broke off, I started with drilling holes down the center with, these hadn't arrived for Amazon yet, so I tried these extractors and I broke one off because I did not allow this wedge-shaped extractor to seat far enough in there, so it broke. I then had to get that hardened steel out, so I went to die grinder land and found these were quite helpful. When I finally got those two studs out, I went after another two, and I thought they were okay, but they actually were effectively stuck inside the head right around this shoulder here. And the threads there, so it looked like the stud had integrity, but it actually just spun when I tried to extract it. I managed to finally get that out, and after drilling out the first stud, and it's really hard to drill these small studs out off center, I used one of these taps here on the end of a drill, in this case, because I have air, but I also prefer the speed control, these newer tools. Something like this doesn't always give you the speed control required to drill into your aluminum or hardened steel properly. You'll exceed the bit's heat ability to shed heat, or the piece that you're drilling into. So yeah, anyways. So yeah, right angle drill, pretty helpful. Not everybody has access to that, so do your best to see what you can do. I ended up picking up this type of bit, and that helped me extract. I wish I'd had it when I broken this off, but I didn't. But when I broke this off, which is a tap from Harbor Freight, it includes the drill bit and tap all in one tool. Anyways, trying to get that out of there and chase it down the hole was a challenge. So obviously the hole got bigger and bigger in the aluminum head. So what helped me was getting this step stud. So if you can find these, like I said, in those timing belt kits or at a local European specialty shop, try to bring beer or something to a mechanic or look it up online for a double-ended step-down stud in the appropriate threading, and you should be good to go. I put this in after tapping it to 10 by 1.5, and I've been able to tighten the exhaust manifold down to the required torque spec, which is, there we go, 22 newton meters, 16 foot pounds, or because I do inch pounds on the particular torque wrench that I have, it's 192 inch pounds. So, what else do we do? Got a brand new gasket here that's not covered in oil and all swollen. I focused on the exhaust manifold because that's where I had most of my problems, but not everybody's going to have that sort of outcome. when you're pulling off the intake manifold, you'll notice a variety of different lengths of fasteners here. Here's the one I cleaned up. Looks quite a bit better, I think. And I'll go into that JB weld that you've probably already noticed in a second. As you're trying to extract these, bending over the car and trying to fit a 6mm Allen key in, either on a, you know, a wobble socket or a ball end, you know, 6mm Allen key that you're able to get in there and reach around and you know, get into all this stuff. It could be a bit of a challenge, so I sorted through the bolts after putting them in a solvent tank and pulled the ones out that had, you can see the obvious deformation around these. Lucky to have a few extras around. This one's fine. But some of them get pretty bad, and having one of those stripped out behind there, it'll really ruin your day. So yeah, get a good bit. Make sure it's fairly new. If a wobble bit doesn't work, you know, that's okay. Just keep trying until you can get it loose. What else was there? I highly recommend picking up, if you don't already have one, a ratcheting tap handle. It's very awkward to thread those holes in on the back of that engine while it's still mounted in the car. Didn't know if I went over this, but the other thing I'll be replacing, because I've had it in my garage forever, is the throttle body gasket. There's your part number for it. I don't know how long I've had this for, but I guess it's finally time to use it. I don't find that those, or the fifth injector port on the back here, the gasket is stuck to the fifth injector, I think. Anyways, I don't find those tend to leak just because they don't have the same sort of surface area to erode and deform, and even this isn't that big a deal. It just sits up very high on the engine. It's really not really the heat, it's the heat with the combination of the oil that takes out these. The other thing that had been leaking oil onto the engine, onto the intake manifold and exhaust manifold, was the oil filling cap. This thing is, you can get replaced, you don't have to replace the whole cap. You can get just this plastic, or not plastic, you can get a new seal for it. And this one here, as you can tell, is, you can hear it snap. It's just ridiculous. So this is, it's just been on here. Rubber's not supposed to look like that. It's supposed to be a lot more flexible, unless this is the Antarctic, which it's not. So, exhaust manifold, gaskets, intake manifold. What else did I do here? Yeah, thoroughly check all of your intake boots. Since again, I am going after, and I can't show you on video because I need both hands, but you really need to stretch and pull these things apart, and especially in the ribs here, to make sure there's nothing hidden. Worn engine mounts also exacerbate tearing of those aged rubber boots. So, you know, as everything wears here, engine mounts, oil seals, all that sort of stuff, as the engine mounts wear out, it takes out your exhaust system hangers, it makes your shifting worse because your engine's not in the same spot. It damages all the rubber hoses, it can eventually cause incontinuity in the electrical system, you know, as those electrical wires are moved back and forth from constant acceleration and deceleration in the engine moving in the engine bay. We'll also take out the rubber boots again on the intake system. So you know, just keeping up on maintenance on these tends to help reduce what seem to be unrelated problems, but are actually more than just a correlation. Yeah, I think I'm pretty much done summarizing what I've done here. Take your time, especially with exhaust manifold studs. The reason I use this step down stud is that I'm just not ready to rebuild the cylinder head yet. When I do rebuild it, I will have the rebuilder weld up that hole and retap it, so I'm not putting a 10 millimeter stud in there that's a step down. I'd like to have it to be stock, but I also want to get it on the road. These are just new studs that I picked up to replace the old ones. I did replace every single one. I mean, if the stud's stuck in there, you can leave it, but you're just passing on to the next person, and you could be passing on that stud breaking just from heat cycling and corrosion down the road, and it won't leave you stranded, but it can get kind of irritating. Other than that, yeah, I think that's everything that I had to do on this car, and here comes the train, so it's good timing for me to sign off. Yeah, I'll continue getting this back together, and we'll see how it idles after I have gone after every single one of those air leaks there. Thanks for watching.